Hello, everyone. We are now at lecture 4.1. This lecture is about multimodal representation. Should be a fun lecture. So let's start with some administrative things. A usual reminder, I will probably put it in every lectures just to remind you, if you have any question, log in right now on Piazzal and click on, or you should see live Q&A, and that will allow you to see and post questions. At the end of the lecture, I will take the time to also go on all of these questions and answer or follow up on any of them if there is any need to follow up. So a TA is also live chatting and answering. So this is great. We have pre-proposals completed, and all students managed to find teammates. So that's very exciting. The list of topics is great. And we assign and match all of your projects to a TA, and they should have contacted you already through Piazza. So just double check your emails. You should have received through Piazza a message from your primary TA. Your primary TA is the person to contact with any questions, primarily about the course project, but also anything else. They are there for you. They are there to help you. We don't have official office hours because we found that this idea of primary TA with who you meet regularly through the semester to work really well in answering all your questions. So as any time, if you would like an extra meeting, I'm always happy. And we'll have, in fact, not this coming week, not this week, not the next one, but on week 6, we will have, there's no lectures those two, Tuesday and Thursday, on purpose to give you more time to work on the first project assignment. But also, I will use these times as some virtual office hours as well. So, so the first project assignment is coming in a little bit more than 2 weeks. So it's good to start working now. Don't wait. I've already told you, like, don't wait 2 days before the deadline. This is not the type of project report you want to wait 2 days before. The project report has 3 main parts. The first one will be relatively easy. This is a restatement of the introduction and the experimental setup you're planning for the project. This will be probably some extension and rewriting on the pre-proposal, but in the same vein. One part that will require time, but it's good to do it before and not after the project, is the idea of studying related work. And we want you to cite 12 to 15, a minimum of 12 papers in your related work section. 3 or 4 of these should be like the most related to your work, and these you should even like give a little bit more details about these, not to the point of writing equation, but at least writing 2 or 3 sentences about these most relevant and how they compare with your proposed work. And then the core one of the main core is the new research ideas. And don't worry, at this point, this is still early in the project. You may have some ideas, not completely sure about it. Don't worry, just write them down. This is our idea. The goal is to give you feedback. In fact, this coming week, you should be meeting with your TA, primary TA, to discuss those research ideas. And as you start working with the data, you will probably realize that how to tweak or change these ideas. So part 2 is about sharing your research ideas. A rule of thumb, if you have a team of 4, I'm kind of expecting about 3 ideas in this. If you have a team of 5, 4 ideas, that's one less as the number of teammates. Part number 3 is where you will have the most coding to be done. And the goal is threefold. One is to just get yourself used to and also start understanding your data set. So each data set has its own particularities, so it's really important for that. The main two goals of part three is to look at language in itself. These are unimodal explorations, and try to find how is language related to your task. What is the type of structure you see in your language? And so the simplest one, which is the one we suggest in the instructions, is to just look at lexical representation and semantic representation and see how these relate to your labels, to your class, to your task. You should try to qualitatively visualize these. This is really an exploration. This is qualitative, but also to try to understand, like, are they in my big data set? Are they some, let's say you do instruction following. Are they different kind of verbs that are used in my following instructions? And it's probably useful for me to know what is that, all these type of words, because some words, some verbs may be very easy to replicate with an AI system, and some other verbs may be much harder. And so qualitatively understanding that is important, but also using some embeddings, like we already talked about Word2Vec, and we'll talk about other ones next week. The goal is to explore the data and also explore the tools, understand the tools themselves. So language exploration, and for visual, we expect you to use CNN and at least run a CNN on your data, or at least on a subset of your data. If your data set is too big, takes too long to run, it's okay to do it on a subset. But we want you to understand, like, you have all these images. Let's say also it's about following instructions. And like room to room or some other data set like it. We want to see what are those images, what are the objects that are seen there, how is CNN picking up on these objects, how are these maybe objects related to your task. Let's say the task is turn left, can you see some relationship or picking up objects specifically like verbs? So we want to do the visual and the language. These explorations, we on purpose ask you to do them on your own data set, which also means that the instructions are a little bit vague because it's very hard to create one set of instruction for this part three that works for all possible data sets that you guys are working on, which can be quite different from each other. So for that reason, we decided to leave it a little bit qualitative, a little bit general in the instruction, and you work with your TAs to confirm if they are correct or how to explore for your specific data set. So talk with your TA about this. The part that is going to be really interesting this year, because this is the first time we will do it remotely. Usually the proposal presentation were in person. This time we will them remotely. So what it means is that you are recording, you're making a recording of your presentation. And in this recording, you only focus on the research ideas. Don't focus on the unimodal exploration or on the visual exploration. Or you could discuss very quickly related work, but the core of that presentation is to explain your research ideas. And the reason for that is that we have a second part, which you could say almost as a third part, like report, proposal, presentation. And then the last part will be peer feedback, feedback from other students. And so for the purpose of presentation, focus only or primarily on the research ideas you have, because the feedback, you want to get feedback about it. And we will have students watching, your peer student watching it and giving feedback. When you submit, you need to submit two things, your video recording, MP4, and there's a link. It's in the instructions also, which are the instructions for the presentation are now online on Piazza. And you need to submit a PDF version of your slides, and they need to match to each other. Like, don't try to submit your MP4 and then changing it or vice versa. They need to match with each other. The deadline for it is Friday, in 16 or 17 days from now. So you see, you need to start thinking about it. The deadline for the deadline for the report is the Sunday right after. So Friday is the presentation, and Sunday the 11th is the report due. We give you two more days to finish the report. We want the proposal presentation earlier because we need to prepare for the peer feedback. So all the videos, because they're submitted on Box, we will put links to this on one big post. We have 24 projects, so all 24 projects with their videos will be there. And we will also have 24 posts, separate posts, one for each project. And the reason is to be able to submit your feedback to the team. So any feedback you want to post on a specific project, you will have a post associated with each of them. And your goal is to watch at least six of them. We'll give details about the matching, how to match you with the other projects. But yeah, on the six videos, you should watch. And for them, for these six, there's a minimum of six. You're very welcome to comment on a lot more, all 24 of them, like we are planning to do. But you also like leave a decent, like at least 120 words feedback about it, about the ideas, maybe pointers you found, that the kind of follow-up you could or alternative they could explore. And these feedback is the following Friday. So we have one whole week. It may take us a day max to put everything together. We'll do it as fast as possible. And then you have another 5 or 6 days to share the feedback. So this is the main thing. If you have questions about it on Piazza, we'll answer anything, or at the end of this lecture, I will be happy to answer them. Today, our presentation is about multimodal representation. The focus today is primarily about these multimodal representation, coordinated joint representations. But I will also, before that, discuss for a little moment about graph-based representation. And I'm presenting this because this was discussed a few times in the comments from lecture 2.1 and some follow-up comments afterwards. People were asking about graph-based representations. And given that, I'm happy to give a little bit more details on this. Also some pointers for people who are interested to read more. So I want to share that knowledge is one of these things we will want to represent in a graph. So last week it was language, vision, and now I just want to present graph representation. And there's this great tutorial from Professor Leskovec from Stanford on this topic, which I invite you to look at. So we, last week, at the end of last lecture Thursday, we discussed tree-based RNN or recursive RNN. And the idea here was to be able to represent or take advantage of a tree structure like a parsing tree and use this in a LSTM type recursive network or recurrent neural network. And the big change here was the idea that instead of having modeling this this type of sentences as a sequence, we take advantage of the parsing information and use this to aggregate the information. So we use this parsing information to change, instead of using it and simply doing a sequence, which is the typical LSTM. Here we will aggregate information in a way that takes advantage of parsing. Now, this is great when you have a tree-based parsing, but in many cases, the information is not through a tree and can be a lot more unstructured. And how can we take advantage of that not completely unstructured, but that structure can be a lot more flexible. And the term, just terminology, some people call them graphs. There's also networks. I will sometimes mix that. I will use one and the others. the graphs or networks. I will use both the terminology. So social network, Facebook or Twitter, these social networks are very large scale version of a graph where every node is a person. You also have an economic view, or also in a company, when you have a company and all the workers, how they interact with each other. You have it from a knowledge base or from the web, how the web page are related to each other, or the brain, how the brain neurons are related to each other. These are early examples where a representation of a graph will be a great way to move and to represent information. And when you have a graph like this, there are many tasks that could be done. One of them is clustering, and I will talk about this kind of unsupervised approaches or similarity-based approaches. But another one will be about a supervised task. An example, if you have online social network and you would like to detect which of these actors or these people on the social network are human and which one are in fact just a bot, you could expand to that to be looking at topics. Or so the goal is to be able to from your network, be able to label an associated subset of nodes. Now, it could be a subset of nodes, and because you already have some of the labels, or it could be all nodes, both tasks can be explored. There is quite a few cases where you already have some and you'd like to kind of propagate the labels to other in your. So that's also a very interesting aspect of this. So this is one way a graph can be used, and in this case is a supervised task, and this is the one type of learning you'd like to do. Another one, which is closer to unsupervised task, is to take advantage of this structure. And so the structure may be defined because of like friends, or it could be defined because there is a web page linked to another. And the goal may be to learn in that kind of unsupervised, or the only supervision you will have is the links. So either you call it completely unsupervised or you call it weakly supervised, but the only information you will have are those links, but no labels. And our goal will be to learn a similarity and learn an embedding in such a way that in this embedding space, two nodes that are connected, that are similar, and the similarity could be just like, is it connected or not, like zero or one, or you could have it sometime have a weight associated with it, how connected or close they are. And you want to use this and be sure that in that embedding space, this is a constant in the sense that two things that are connected will also be very close in the embedding space. And you could imagine on top of that, having some kind of clustering on top of that as well. So this is more of an unsupervised task. And this is, I will say, a little bit of a classic approach. Many of the network base will often explore these clustering, trying to understand the data. Let me formalize a little bit graph neural network, or just at the basic, a graph in itself. A graph is a series of vertices or nodes. You can call them nodes or vertices. And then you have edges, connections between them. And often these edges can be represented by something like an adjacency matrix. Adjacency matrix could be just binary in the sense that zero or one if this is connected, or zero otherwise. So this is the basic of a graph. In the case of a graph neural network, often you will associate with each of these vertex or these nodes, you may associate also some descriptors for these. It could be categorical. You could have like attributes like age or gender, or you could have some text associated with them, images. There's a lot of very interesting information. And that's probably closer to what we do. And what you see here that's very interesting is that this data could be multimodal. In fact, there are some very interesting work where maybe some of your nodes have text and some of your nodes have images and some of your nodes. So it could be that your network is in fact multimodal in the sense that it could be multimodal in the sense that every node have all these different type of information. All of the above is really interesting. One thing that is optional, and mostly in the case of the supervised, is that you may have associated either just during training or maybe also at test time, nodes and labels for these different nodes. As I mentioned, this is optional. If you do the unsupervised, it's not required. So this is the formulation. And so there are quite a few approaches, but a lot of them uses similar ideas. And this is a nice intuition. And that's a little bit similar intuition that we had in the tree RNN. And the idea here is that if I want model the graph, it can be a very complex graph. And so how can I take this graph and make it into a neural network? The first key intuition is to look at neighbors. So I will look at it. It's has almost the same kind of intuition as Monte Carlo, like MCMC, like a little bit. But that intuition, a lot of these Markov assumptions of looking with your click and looking like this is a little bit of a similar for people who work on this topic. But yeah, the intuition here is locally the information. What is connected with A, for example? It's D, B, and C. And so as at the first level, these three are the most relevant with A, and this is where I get most of my information. Now, in practice, like B can also be connected with C, but C is also connected with F and E. So A indirectly should have a connection with F and E. So, but at the first level, we want to have it local. So if I have a target like A, we are at the first level, we'll say, hey, what really connects or with the knowledge, what is the messages I want to get or what is the relationship is my neighbors and myself, maybe myself and the neighbors. These are really what is really key into that. But we'll make it a multi-layer and in kind of a recursive manner, going from A, I can say from B, what is related to B? And it's A and C. And that's what you see here. And from C, what is related? It's A, B, C, E, and F. And what is related to D? Only A. And so now you can see, and you can see that recursive going on. And what will allow us is that like a relation between C and A will still be modeled just after two layers of neurons. And in fact, these will be in fact neural networks. That's where, at least in recent works, has been used as an aggregators and learning how to aggregate this information. One thing that's important to realize is that this kind of network is created based on the input graph. You create these networks, and for each target node, you get a different of these graph. That's really interesting. So this input graph gives us those six different graphs. And here we're only showing two layers, okay? And I'm writing it again. So the same graphs here, I'm writing them again here. And so here we have multiple layers. We have the original input. We have a first layer. We have a second layer. And there's nothing that stops us from doing a lot more layers. Almost nothing that stops us. I will tell you more in a second. But in general, in theory, you could go as far as you go, as you want. There one issue that we'll discuss is the same that we had in other neural network. If you add many layers, what is the issue? Vanishing gradient. So the same issue will happen also here. But in general, in a graph neural network, this is an example of a graph neural network. And how what's very interesting here is the idea of local. That's the first take home, and the idea of multiple layers. These are some of the take home. And another take home, as many of the neural network that we've seen, is that all of the the module, all those aggregation modules here, will all share the same parameters. All of them here at layer two will share. And by default, usually in the basic graph neural net, the parameters will only be shared by layers and will not be shared between layers. And in a multi-layer perceptron, you kind of see a little bit the same thing. Between layer, you get new neural. But the tying of the weights in a little bit like the RNN will do there. So how do you use that kind of architecture? Up to now, the only thing I got is some kind of embedding. Here I get my input X, and here what I have is my output are just Z, like some kind of new embedding for A. But how do I make this kind of output A, Z of A, and use it for supervised? Then I can use probably any loss. I'm just putting one of them here. And there in this loss, I can take this embedding and look at how closely it relates with the label and giving the classification weight. Classification weights are whatever weights that are in my neurons on all of layer one and layer two. So here I am only putting it as if it was a one layer, but in practice, this could be for any, as many layer as I want. So this is, and this is only for binary, human or not, but this could be also multi-class as we've seen. So this is for supervised learning. The one questions and if you were to do unsupervised, I didn't put a slide for this, but there are some very well established algorithms that you can do to also study how to learn and put some kind of supervision on the Z so that eventually you keep the similarity as close to each other. And there's quite a few of these, Node2Vec being one of them, for example. But yeah, one of the questions is, how do you aggregate all of these together? And one of the issues is that sometimes I have three inputs, sometimes I have only one input, sometimes I have four inputs. So how do I aggregate multiple of these? How can I handle multiple? And probably the first thing that comes to mind is average pooling. I can end up just averaging. Here what I have is I take all of my H here and I just average them, and then I just multiply by my W, and here I just made the W. I didn't put the bias here. And one thing also is to be remembering is that you should also have probably with yourself, you should probably remember the previous how was A at the previous layer? How was A before I make this aggregation? So you want to keep some consistency here. And so these different, one thing that is the average pooling, at least the one that was originally proposed, was that the way you aggregate all of the all of your neighbors will have different weights than the way you process your own representation from the previous iteration or the previous layer. One extension which got a lot of interest in the AI community is the graph convolution neural network. It's a small change from the more typical average pooling, where in fact you end up treating the self node, you end up treating it with the same weights. So you don't learn a different W or BK, but in fact use the same. And one other thing, and what's nice by doing that is that it suddenly things are going to become a lot more efficient. So every node can efficiently be processed because there's the same set of weights for every node, whether it's myself or another. And by adding a simple different normalization, that's one small change that they did in the graph count. But the bigger change was probably this change of weight, because that changed also the efficiency of the algorithm. But one of the issue, like average pooling and graph convolution networks, is that naturally, by default, they will have a harder time with very very complex and multiple layers. They will have the same issue that we've seen in some basic RNN. And for that reason, people have looked at extension. And one of the interesting one was, which is probably makes sense, the same way RNN, if you want to help with the vanishing gradient, then you can use an LSTM or a GRU. I didn't discuss in this case in details the GRU. GRU can be seen as a somewhat of a simplification of an LSTM, but the goal is the same, is to help with the vanishing gradient. And so the GRU is gonna be the same GRU formulation as in a recurrent neural network, but here we're gonna use the GRU over layers. Because where's the problem with vanishing gradient? The vanishing gradient is not from left to right, is from up to down, is from between layers. And so the GRU is gonna be helpful between layers. And that will be how we will be using it. So same weights also across layers. So suddenly what is nice is that you're also gonna have in this architecture, the same weight, because if you have, if you make it a recurrent process over layers, then suddenly, the same set of weight at layer one, at layer two. And so that will allow, because of the GRU, will allow to do a deeper project, so a deeper network. So there are some citations here, some of the like landmark works in this, and there's been some extension. One that I didn't have time to talk about, but that is quite interesting, is called subgraph embedding. So the same way we in the language, we look at word-based embedding. So you have a sentence and you look at embedding each word. But what if I wanted to embed a sentence in a graph? Like in a graph, I want to embed a subgraph. Like there's a big graph and there's a subpart of the graph, and I'd like to have one embedding for the whole graph. Hey, you can probably see the same intuition as we had with sentence embedding. And so that's a really nice and interesting aspect that is, and it's still an open question on that. So great. So I wanted to talk about these graph-based embedding, but the main focus today will be on multimodal representations. What do we want with a multimodal representation? Our goal, what are our goals when learning these multimodal representation? At the first level, we want to identify similarity in that space. We want the same way, in a sense, as we just talked about embedding in the graph, but this is true with multimodal entities that or concept that are similar or equivalent in different modalities, they should, in that representation, they should have both be similar as well. We want probably also this representation to be useful for prediction tasks like retrieval, mapping, and fusion. So the representation could be learned unsupervised, but also but we want to hopefully you be useful for another prediction task, or I say prediction task here in the figure, but it could be also for other analysis as well, like clustering as well. We want it to possible to obtain in absence of modalities. That's one thing that we didn't discuss as much here, but sometime with specifically with joint representation, what is one of the advantages you may want is that this representation should be, we should be able to use it even if we have a subset of representation. And sometimes you want it to also fill a missing modality at the other. So maybe even though the modality is not present, you may be able to use that multimodal representation in some kind of translation perspective. So these are different applications or different ways to use representation, multimodal representation. I just bring back the core challenges that I discussed about 2 weeks ago on multimodal representation. One way of learning representation is joint representation. And that is one of the core aspects of today, what we'll discuss. Joint representation is this idea where everything goes, all modalities will end up in that same space, and things that are similar to each other will be close to each other. But as I hinted at already, and we'll discuss more on Thursday, there's another field, a subfield of coordinated representation. I will say it's also probably the one that has been the least explored, and I think very interesting aspect. And so in a coordinated representation, instead of pushing everything together in the joint space, you will say, hey, I will have a separate space for my two modalities, but I will find a way, I will force some aspect of each spaces to be coordinated with each other. It could be some elements in the two modalities that are similar to each other, and I want these to be close. I could also make it so that there's another way to translate from one to another modality. So that the coordination could be, it's kind of a spectrum from very weak coordination. The weakest of it is to have two separate spaces that are not connected to any kind of coordination. And then you have the strongest, which in fact end up being joint representation. So you have this this representation. I want to discuss when you learn these representation, the idea of learning unsupervised. And we hinted at this also when I talk about the graph-based representation. And at the basic, like just from a notation perspective, the idea is you have data, but no label. And why would you want to tackle is to often unsupervised learning allows us to do some analysis about in the data by looking at the similarity and clustering that we can learn from that. We can find, for example, the famous topic modeling. Sometimes it's helpful also for data compression, looking at trend. And often, and in the case of neural network, it may be seen almost as a pre-training to use a lot of data to learn a better representation that could maybe use better later for a supervised task. So unsupervised representation, it's to force a representation to better model the input, not just extracting the feature for classification, asking the model to better represent the data. This is more about representation learning in general. And so for students who read the paper on representation learning, you've seen that, and hopefully everyone through the discussion also picked up on all these main points. And this unsupervised will also hopefully help with generalization. And as I mentioned, it's a lot of time can be used for initialization. So the representation learning, and I reduce a little bit the number of slides on this. I think it's a very cool algorithm, and we'll discuss a little bit more when we talk about probabilistic graphical model. But RBM, restricted Boltzmann machines, were some of the most, some of the original multimodal, I will say two of the landmark papers. One was using auto-encoder, the deep multimodal learning, multimodal deep learning. But there was also very soon after One on RBM. The RBM being nice because it was a generative model. So this one could really be learned really just from the input. So from the input, you concatenate your input, and then you through the RBM algorithm, will learn a representation. Usually that shared representation will be a little bit smaller to force some kind of aggregation of the data. But although RBM are great and conceptually are very interesting, in practice, there are a lot of challenges in optimizing them. And so, although both came at the same time, definitely one of the two really took over the other very quickly. And the autoencoder is the one that really came out stronger of the two, primarily for the optimization. So what the autoencoder, first, what does it mean, autoencoder? It means, auto means self. So encoding itself, that's the intuition. And so the an autoencoder at its basic is just a feed forward. It is, an autoencoder is a multilayer perceptron. It's a feed forward neural network. It's just that it has been architectured in a certain way, and also the losses will be slightly different, and also sometimes it's trained layer by layer. So, but generally, like at inference time, at the time of inference, it is a multilayer. It's a feedforward network. It's a the output of the network will be the prediction, will be how well could you recreate your input? That's the idea here. So that's what the output, or what I call usually in MLP, the score function, but the output will be the original input. And we'll split it in usually in two parts, the encoder and the decoder. And a classic, although it's not required, but a classic autoencoder will have more of an hourglass where information comes to this middle layer, which intermediate layer that usually is a lot smaller with number of neurons that forces aggregation and fusion of information. And then you will have this decoder that will then try to, from that summarized information, be able to regenerate the initial. And if you look at it, this is not far from the word to vec. This is one difference is that in the word to vec, we were not trying to recreate yourself, but in fact recreate the context, but the similar architecture to that. Often in autoencoders, they will also share or tie the weights between it, and that will also help because that way, however you regenerate the data should be related to how you however you decode or generate the data, it should be related to how you encode it. Also, it could be seen as the intuition in the brain. There's some famous result that says that the way people perceive speech is related also to the way they generate speech. So you could also intuitively come at it from a cognitive science perspective. So this is the basic of autoencoder. I just want to add one more thing about autoencoder before I get to the multimodal, which is how do you define the loss in this case? And the loss can be different. It could be, there's different version, but the key aspect of it is that you will compare usually your input with the output simply by hoping that they are as close to each other. Sorry for the small typo. But how to make it more robust to noise? There was this nice little, nice cute extension to it, which is called denoising autoencoder. And the idea here is that I will not look at the input itself, but add a noisy version. So not the input itself, but look at a noisy version of it. And so the network will go from the noisy, and then the loss will be trying to get the original version of that. So, So the network will be learning from this, but the loss will be from the original version, that getting as close as possible. And that will be usually bring matter. Often people just talk autoencoder without talking about the denoising itself, but it's a nice trick to be had. But let's talk about multimodal. So how can you make this option autoencoder multimodal? Think about it for a second. How can I take this idea of autoencoder and make it so that I can learn a multimodal? So this is maybe, or at least one of the ideas you had. This is a bimodal autoencoder. And one of the key aspects of it is that it does joint representation or shared representation. Okay, so joint representation, which is different from coordinated. We'll talk next week, not next week, on Thursday. But here is joint representation. What it means is, and how will you train this joint representation? One thing that they maybe don't always say explicitly, but is very important, is, and many of these, is that you need paired data. You need data between the two modalities. You need to have this data. So I have my audio and I have my video, and I need to be able to I need that paired data. So in the case of audiovisual speech recognition, it will be maybe the video with the, or maybe just the lip tracking, the tracking of the lips. In this case, I think it was not the raw video, but they look at the lip shape. And then you have the audio. And again, they will probably not take the raw audio, but instead use spectrogram of some other representation. And then what it is the goal is to go and encode the representation. And so I get this both inputs, and then I find this joint representation. And then also what's very challenging also from that joint representation inside it, there's a need to have enough information in it to be able to regenerate video and regenerate audio. So as you can imagine, this is very challenging because the shared representation needs to include enough information to regenerate both of them. But if you can and learn this, and the initial results were pointing that way. One little thing that they did that was somewhat important is that the initial layers of these encoder and decoder, and these layers, and for the video, were already pre-trained. You often will do that also. You may pre-train this, and in this case, they pre-trained it with a typical autoencoder. And then once you pre-train that, then you can train and use both together. And that's the usual way. What you to train the model to reconstruct both modality. But what's really cool, once you've done that, so you train, you pre-train this, and then you train together. And then what's really cool after that is that you can go and remove one. What will happen? And it's a little bit, we talk about the blue car. I mean, that would have been the other idea. Like, I have an image and a caption, and I learn it together. Video representation, that joint representation, I should be able from it to be able to sample video, but also I should be able to generate and sample audio. And it's really cool. I can in fact remove video as well from it. So these are very interesting aspects of the autoencoder that comes from this extension. It can be now even discarded. You can completely, so one thing you can do is completely discard the decoder. And now let's say you have my video and my speech, and I want to learn a new task. Let's say it is speech recognition. So I'm trying to predict language, like the words, the spoken words. I can use now my shared representation to also recognize language. And then I can do some cool thing. So at training, I could train So I pre-train. I pre-train with this way. In fact, not this way, but completely this way. So I pre-train this way. But then I fine-tune it for the class of predicting words. Okay, so I do speech recognition. Here that was speech, this is video. And in my first version of the training, I had both audio and video. But in my second stage, I only have audio and language. And then at test time, which is, this is a co-learning kind of scenario. At test time, I don't have audio, but I can go ahead. And because I had trained earlier in the pre-train, I had pre-trained also, I will be from video able to read lip reading. I mean, they're cool, no? I mean, the results, it was early on, and there's a lot that followed up this, but that was really cool. I wanted to also discuss, although mathematically I'm not talking yet about restricted Boltzmann machine, I want to talk about the results of that paper, because the results of the paper was really cool. And these are two of the, I will say, landmark papers in the neural multimodal that really, really started a lot of work. In this case, they didn't look at speech recognition. They look at image and text. And what they do is that when you have a generative model like IBM, what they can do is that you get your initial representation of the text. Let's say for now, let's call it word to vec. So I get my word to vec here, and the image is like maybe the output of a CNN. And then what will I do? I will learn a first layer. So this will be trained together. And this generative model, because these maybe have a lower, smaller number of neurons, then I will start summarizing a little bit the image. And on this side, I will start summarizing the text. And then I will train now the second layer, And then the interesting one is to train the joint representation. And in practice, you will make it so it's almost, you can also do it step by step, or at the end, you can also do it like end to end. But what's really interesting is, now what do I have? I have my input on both sides, and I have five intermediate representations. I have an intermediate representation here, intermediate representation. And the information can flow both ways, because generative, and in this case, it can go both ways. And so it will be really interesting to say, I mean, I hypothesize that the middle representation is the most, like, that's the most intermediate, but there's nothing that forces it. Maybe this one is really the intermediate, the middle point, or maybe this one is the middle point. And so that's one question that you have. The training for that is variational approaches. And as I mentioned, we'll discuss more the training. But the result, I'm going to come back to the result. I want to show you this graph. What's really interesting is that it's the mill, and the comparison between the two is not as important as the let's just look at the red one. What's really interesting is to see how much information, how successful the task that we have is, I think, image, multimodal image retrieval. The idea would be maybe the middle is the best. But what was really interesting is to see the asymmetry between this. The fact that text was different from the image, although the two together are really useful, you can see that there's an asymmetry between them. And somehow this one gained a lot from the image. So the text very quickly gained a lot from the image, but that was different on the other side. So it's interesting to look. Like often we only talk about one intermediate representations, but in some models, in these generative models, you can start looking at the flow of information between that. And so the task here, you can pre-train on unlabeled data. It's unlabeled, but really there's some supervision, which is there's pairing of data. I mean, you have paired data. And then when you do with the unsupervised task, then you can do these things where you have an image as input, and then you can see the generated tags and compare with the ground truth tags, or the opposite. You have a text as input, sample images from that text, and so you can. It's a fully generative model, so both ways, and so that's the beauty of this model. And then it can be used on a prediction task. So, and that was what the graph I was showing also is that. So you train originally, pre-train unsupervised, but then you train it on visual. And the beauty of it here, and I should have mentioned, is that the only real goal is vision, okay? So I'm gonna now show you the same graph. Here, the prediction, this prediction is only using the input of visual input. And so if you use just vision and you never only use that representation of vision, but then if you start adding and then you can see, but then eventually it gets a little worse with the going in the other direction. So it's also interesting to see that symmetry on both sides. So, okay, this is the generative models that I wanted to discuss. I wanted to also discuss the supervised cases for this multimodal. The supervised case, the idea is that maybe you have a pre-trained representation, but also sometimes you may want to train right away end-to-end for a taskless sentiment. And so the joining of the unimodal representation, it could be simple concatenation like I've shown here. You could multiply the two, like you could multiply HX and HY or learn a multilayer perceptron from it. I showed the multilayer perceptron. But when you do this joint representation, and that's also true with the unsupervised case, but I'm going to show here, is that there is a lot of information that sometimes is unimodal, but sometimes there's complementarity between two modalities, and there's this nice bimodal information. And sometimes there's also complementarity between three modalities, and so we call this trimodal interaction. And so we want to be able to learn these joint representation, but also being able to model bimodal and trimodal interaction. So let's say you have to, in the case of sentiment, you have only what I say, how I say it, the audio, and also my vision. So the simple will be just a concatenation and a neuron on top of that, neural network on top of that. But as I said, there's unimodal, bimodal, and trimodal. And let me give you an example. Like if I say this movie is sick, is it good or bad? It's probably maybe good, but neutral. It's a bit ambiguous, specifically in US. This movie is fair. It's probably positive or neutral. A smile, probably I'm more on the positive side. But if I'm loud, I can be loud and positive or loud and negative. But let's look at bimodal. This movie is sick and I smile. Then it's quite likely that I'm very positive. Or this movie is sick and I frown. Then it's really most likely negative. But this movie is sick and I'm loud, still ambiguous. That's why sometimes you look at trimodal interaction. And in trimodal interaction, then this movie is sick. I smile and I'm loud. Very positive. And I will say the job of multimodal fusion would have been super easy if it was just this kind of example, almost additive, like fusion is additive. But the fusion process is a nonlinear process. As you see here, this movie is fair. Even if I smile, I'm loud, there's fireworks, everything. Because in this case, language takes over the other modalities. And then that means that you should not simply go and go ahead and just add to each of them. No, in this case, language took over the others. And so this kind of nonlinearity is important to be modeled in it, in your model explicitly. And so there has been some very interesting ways to approach it. One nice simple way is called bilinear pooling. And so when the pooling, instead of doing just an average pooling, so I have HX and I have HY, and how I bring it together, I could just average pool them, but here, the idea is to do the product, cross product in such a way that you end up with this matrix. And it's really nice because now suddenly what you have is for each element here, you get those bimodal interactions. So this point here is related with this. So this one is telling you how are dimension one of HX and I dimension two of HX, like this looks at this kind of interaction. So if for sentiment purpose, this interaction is really useful, then this neuron here, neural network here can go and start putting more emphasis on it. Or maybe it's the third one from X and the second one from Y, then this one will be taken. So it's nice because you're kind of exhaustively looking at all possible interaction. This is bilinear pooling. And there was a nice, neat little extension. The bilinear pooling will be, you can go symmetrically. But then there is a small little extension to that, which goes ahead and add this little one to it, like this little one here to the bilinear pooling. It's a very simple idea here. And by taking this little thing, what's really nice is suddenly in your matrix, in your response map here, what you get, what's really nice here is that you get both, both the unimodal and the bimodal. So what you had in the bilinear pooling plus the unimodal as well. And that nothing stops you from doing it in 3D. So now you suddenly have your unimodal, your bimodal, and your trimodal all within one. And what was nice in this is that this approach outperformed the state of the art at that point, but more importantly, it outperformed the bimodal pooling as well. And what you're probably asking yourself, oh, but suddenly I have this huge matrix because suddenly I have this big tensors in your model, huge tensor, and so I have more parameters to learn. And then you have kind of this trade-off. And that's something I hinted at when we talked two weeks ago, about basic of neural network, is sometimes neural network, it is useful to go larger to then go smaller. And so sometimes it is helpful, and that's what it seems to be hinting at in the experiment empirically, to go larger, because here I have more parameters than I had here, but I made it the problem simpler, because it's much simpler from a fusion perspective to just go ahead and pick the input that are the most relevant to my classification task. So although I'm increasing the number, I am making the problem easier. At least that's what empirically it seems to be showing. there is some nice extension you can do to say, hey, this is very big, this tensor, and I have my two modalities, and I have this big tensor, and so I'd like to make it simpler. And there is some nice work that was simply looking at it as a decomposition, where you decompose the weight. So instead of using the weight itself, you keep the step before it, and then you also decompose the tensor and you rearrange them. And so this nice little animation. So you have this big tensor, and what you will do is decompose it. This is a CP decomposition. This is a well-established decomposition that any kind of matrix can be approximated this way, or tensor. And then I will decompose the Z as well, because I know that the Z, it's a matrix here, but the Z came originally from two vectors. And then I will just reshuffle thing, and I will just rearrange things together. And by doing that, what's really nice is that suddenly I get this, which is a lot easier. Like now I can start adding another modality. I can add more and more modality, and it will scale better. One last representation I want to discuss, and then we'll talk about the concept of a temporal, like how do you do multimodal and temporal, and give one example. But one other aspect which we discuss a little bit when we talk about applications of multimodal is earlier when we look at representation, we said, hey, it takes an image and you have paired data, and then I learn joint representation. But there's also the idea of translation. You can also learn a multimodal representation by translating from one to another. It is slightly different here in the RBM. The RBM was a generative model that allows to go both ways. But here, this will be a feed-forward network. And so the image could be a CNN, and the text will be some kind of embedding. And these days, you probably use BERT, but back in then, they could have encoded the language with Word2Vec and an LSTM on top of that. This is another way to do this, and we'll discuss more these kind of translation-based approaches after probably more around week 7. I also want to discuss multimodal LSTM as an example, as an example of temporal modeling. So, because often when we talk about fusion, a lot of people they don't push for the temporal. So fusion, you could always, if you want, highlight and say, hey, I'm only going to look at fusion locally in time. But what's interesting is the simple way of doing fusion, and what I will say 95% of the time, people will do fusion at in a very simple manner from a temporal perspective. There will be maybe some interesting fusion locally in time, but then a lot of approaches don't think about the temporal aspect of the fusion and try to make it part of the fusion process. There was some interesting approach that I want to highlight just as an example. That's not the only way, but I want you to share, because we already discussed LSTM. We'll talk about more of those temporal fusion with transformers, for example, later. But I wanted to give you an example of doing it temporally. How do you do multimodal temporal? And the idea here is called multi-view LSTM. And so the multi-view LSTM, if you remember, one of the key aspects of an LSTM was that memory cell, okay? This memory cell was useful for two things. One, because of the vanishing gradient that helped with this, But also it helped, and we had that forget gate to also help us, in a sense, remembering or forgetting things from time step to time step. So one interesting extension of it is to say, hey, if I have memory, and why not having more than one memory? So in the typical LSTM, I have only one memory, but what if I have in fact multiple memories? I have a memory for modality one, a memory for modality two, a memory for modality three. So what is this? This is a lot closer to a coordinated representation. In fact, you could imagine this architecture, I could do it in such a way that the memory for modality one takes only the input of modality one and the previous hidden state of modality one and ignore completely modality two and three. And if I did that for modality one and similarly for modality two, I ignore modality one and three. If I do this separately in that spectrum of like coordinated representation, I will be at the extreme, like completely like separate representation. So this is one way, extreme way. It's mostly three having, it's exactly the same as having three LSTM separate, one for each modality. But it will be interesting to start looking and exploring what are the different ways I could coordinate between modalities. And the way to do this is the key aspect, the key moment to do this is at this moment where I create that input gate. At the moment of input gate, what will I will start exploring different ways to aggregate. Because this is, if you remember, the input gate is the place where I take my previous hidden state and my new evidences. I take my new evidence and my previous knowledge and aggregate together to create the output of that input gate. And then this will go on. So this is the important moment because that's the moment where I'm bringing together previous knowledge, prior knowledge with new evidences. And that seems to be a key, a perfect place to say, I will not look just about my previous evidence from my own modality and new evidence from my own modality, but I will also take advantage of the other modalities. And so you could imagine different topologies to do that. And I'm only gonna look at for one modality. So for modality one, what do I use? And I to help decide what I aggregate, how do I aggregate knowledge from the other modality, I will introduce two hyperparameters. One is how much from the current modality and how much from the other modalities. And so if I make it extreme, only my current modality and none of the other modality, then what does it mean? This is just three separate LSTM. And the other one is completely ignore what I did and only look at the others. And this is called coupled. And it's really interesting. There is a famous 2000 or maybe even before that paper on coupled HMM. And the extreme version of that, it says, you don't even have your knowledge. And what it means is that you're only gonna get information from the other modality. And so that means that the other modality has to have enough knowledge to create your own modality. So the representation should be as informative as possible to create the other modality. And then maybe I couple again and I create so I can go back and forth like this. That's coupling in practice. If you have two modalities modality A is used for modality B, modality B for modality A, and then I do the modality B for A, modality A for B, and so like this. The alpha and the beta are two hyperparameters in that multi-view LSTM. So in the multi-view LSTM model, alpha and beta, although you could imagine now these days making them a dynamic gate in itself, but for now, so that means for the purpose of this is that alpha and beta are hyperparameters that are decided. And so if you make all of them one and in both case, then suddenly you use both. So you mean the information from my modality and the information of the other. And then finally, you could do any of them. And as I just hinted at, you could make alpha and beta as just a gate like that is dynamically deciding how much do I trust myself and how much do I trust others. So I wanted to share this to be able to introduce quite a few concepts. One is view-specific information. One is coupled way. This is way one way to bring information from other modality. And the specific of this algorithm is just one algorithm, but I want to explore that. And multi-view LSTM does improve on that. What we will do next week, and this is just a little preview for, not next week, but tomorrow, Thursday, we'll talk about coordinated representations. And coordinated representation, you learn through representation, but you coordinate. And I told you, this is a spectrum of things. And if your coordination between these two, left and right, like text and image, are so strong, like a similarity matrix, like a cosine distance. If you want the cosine distance to be as small as possible, as we've seen in embeddings, like with language embedding, if you force them to be as far, as close as possible, you're mostly making it so that these are mostly the same, or at least their cosine distance is the same. So this is in the spectrum of things, very, very strong correlation. But it turned out that some of the papers I talked to you about, and so what will be the loss function? And so one is to have it very strong, like a cosine similarity. There is another one, which is you have the two distance and you could make it as a max margin, which is a little bit related to what's really popular these days as contrastive learning. But yeah, so do you want to get the positive? Do you don't care or it's okay, but you want to make the negative, you want to pay a price for the negative cases. And that was, if you ask also one key papers one key papers was the multimodal deep learning with autoencoder. You have the RBM one that I talk about, and this is another one, devise, or French way to pronounce it, will be to bring these two embeddings together. This was a simpler one. There's different kind of ways and of looking at these, and that's one of the paper that I think this one I may have put as optional or not. I forgot if I put it optional or not, is that there's ways to learn their embedding in such a way that you, in this case, you only focus on the negative example, but there's also structure preserving constraint. And the intuition here is you want image that share the same meaning to be close to each other, and then the others are outside. So it's kind of if you're close to each other, then you want the same meaning. Otherwise, it's not. So it's structural preserving because it the structure meaning if you have some kind of symmetry, similarity function, or closeness or neighborhood, then you can use that to help in the learning. And one of the paper that we proposed was about extending the basic one to do that. I wanted to share these different approaches. We'll talk more on Thursday about those different coordinated approaches and discuss different approaches like this. So thank you very much for your attention.